Well, he said he had about a minute left. If he wants to continue to thank the brilliance of the organizers, we'll give you some more time. Next up, we're going to change up a little bit. We're going to talk about partnership, and we're going to also talk about disruption. Coming to the stage first is we've got Margaret Keane. She's the CEO and president of Synchrony Financial. Her dual passions of emerging technology and employee development have led many to conclude that she's one of the top leaders in business. Next up, we have Sebastian DiGrande. Sebastian is the Executive Vice President of Strategy and the Chief Customer Officer at Gap, where he focuses on deepening the company's relationship with customers at the intersections of technology, strategy, and digital innovation. And finally, we've got Ryan McInerney, the president of Visa, where he's responsible for leading the company's global client organization. I was thinking about Ryan on the way up because Ryan was one of the leaders who helped us put together the FinTech Ideas Festival. And with all your ideas, Ryan, you had one that was really important. Ryan pulled me aside. He said, "Eric, no matter what you do for the FinTech Ideas Festival, make sure you don't let people wear ties." So with that, we're glad to have Margaret Sebastian.
I didn't wear a tie. Stage.
Only one important idea, Eric, huh? No, I got it. I hear it. Good feedback. I'm going to play the role of both facilitator and participant on the panel, which is also known as an unfair advantage, but I'm happy to do it. And I think that the topic's a really important one. And to be honest, for almost all of us in the room, a really hard one. The idea of partnerships and the role that they play in the world that we all live in right now. So, Margaret, I'll start with you and just maybe talk a little bit about why is this topic of partnerships important? How does it play a role in your business?
Sure. Our business is a B2B business, so we are all about partnerships. If you think about the merchants and customers like the Gap, who we've had for 18 years, you know, our job for the Gap is pretty simple. We have to wake up every day to figure out how do we sell more product for Gap using our cards in their various brands. I mean, it's a pretty simple mission, but in order to do that, there has to be an incredible amount of integration between us and our partner to make sure we really ensure that the customer experience through that whole process is really seamless and really effective. And I think when you think about technology right now and where the world is going, I think it's moving so fast that people that maybe we wouldn't partner with before, we're having very different levels of conversation. I even think about our partnership with Visa. You know, we are sitting in rooms talking about the Gap in a different way. What else can we be doing jointly for the Gap to help them grow their business? And, you know, I think when you think of the competitive environment, the FinTech space, and our ability to maybe bring things faster to our partners, you know, if you think about the retail space that we're in, you know, I wouldn't say that IT is usually their first thought, right? And this is where we can add value in terms of helping them accelerate certain things that they're trying to do for their customers. And we have to constantly bring new ideas to them to really keep that partnership fresh and really grow. So for me, I think this whole world of partnerships is really an area that is opening up in so many different ways, where we're having dialogue and opportunities come to the table that in the past we probably would have shunned. We would have said, oh, we don't want this person, right? We're not going to talk to this person. And I think the reality now is we're all working, I think, more effectively together to really think about how do you accelerate change? How do you drive technology? How do you continue to grow the business that you're in?
How about you, Sebastian? What do you think?
Well, I mean, look, I personally, hello, everyone. Personally, I come from the world of technology originally, and in technology, it's been a decade or two decades now of the word ecosystem being the big catchphrase. And I think and I think it translates to every industry at this stage. You know, most people think of us as a retailer, and we are. We're a very large retailer with five great brands, but we're more than just a retailer. We have retail. We're also designing, manufacturing, and selling apparel, and ultimately, we're providing customer experiences. So that's a very broad spectrum of things that we have to be able to do and do extremely well. And we've got great people, great talent inside our organization, inside our payments and our loyalty team, our customer teams across the company. But we can't do everything that's needed to ultimately satisfy the demands of our customer by ourselves. So, you know, we have great partnerships with Synchrony, Visa. Those have been longstanding, and that's great, and I expect those to continue. I think over time, and we're already headed down this path, we need to think even more broadly about partnerships even further upstream in the startup community, early stage innovations, participating, partnering, investing, that type of thing, if we're going to be successful in, again, bringing the latest and greatest experiences to our customers.
Yeah, it makes sense. For us at Visa, you know, like Margaret and Synchrony, our whole business is partnerships. We were, you know, we started 60 years ago, not far from where we're sitting today, actually. Just down the road in Fresno, some managers at Bank of America had this idea of a general purpose payment card, and they went and dropped 60,000 pieces of mail. 10 years later, they had 2 million cardholders. I think by any definition, that would have been a huge success, but the people at Bank of America had a very important idea at the time, which is, if we really want to scale this, we have to open it up. We have to open this up to all the banks in the United States. And as we sit here today, we have 3 billion cards around the world, 40 million merchants, 17,000 issuing banks. But as I think 5 years, 10 years, and 15 years out, and Ajay alluded to this on stage at the beginning, we're going to a world where there's going to be 10, 20, 30, 40, 50 billion connected devices. This watch on my wrist is a payment device. This ring on my finger is a payment device. And as we think about, as an industry, how are we going to continue to provide the same safe, simple, secure payment experiences for your cardholders and your customers at the end of the day, the only way it's going to work is through thoughtful partnerships. So, you know, I would say that this issue is as important going forward as it's ever been for those of us in the room. But it becomes even more difficult in a world where a lot of us have to think about how do we partner with people who might also be our competitors, right? And the tough decisions that we're making about how do we determine who are the right people to partner with and how to partner with them. And so maybe back to you, Margaret, as well, is how do you all think about in a world where you might want to partner with someone, but they also could be your competitor or your client's competitor, mm-hmm. How do you make those kinds of decisions?
Well, first I'd say you'd be making a mistake if you weren't thinking about partnering with FinTech. I think they're bringing a whole new way of thinking to at least the financial services industry. And I think there's plenty of room out there for us to partner in different ways. On the other hand, I think you have to be thoughtful about who you're partnering with and to protect, you know, your innovation, to protect the customer base. And I think one of the important things for us, particularly for our partners, is making sure the sanctity of their customers are held whole. So you got to always put that in the forefront. And then you want to make sure that whoever you're partnering with kind of has the same value systems you have, understands the risks of cyber and all those kinds of things that are very real in a financial, highly regulated world, right? But I think there's more opportunity for us to partner with FinTech than not. In terms of people who are maybe in your space, I think what you have to really think about, if the two of you can get together and make the pie bigger, you all win. And I think that's where you really have to look at the pie and the puzzle and say, okay, can we together create an opportunity that's bigger than what it is today? And how do we do this in a rational way where we're doing it in a way that's thoughtful and we're partnering together and, you know, hopefully we're doing this because we're both going to grow. And I think if you have that open mind, I think you'll be able to, you know, you could easily figure out how to put boxes around certain things that might concern you. But I think there's a bigger risk not partnering with FinTech than partnering with FinTech.
How about you, Sebastian? How do you guys think about it from the retailer angle?
Yeah, I mean, look, you know, a lot of people, when they talk about the risk of partnering or the disruption that comes from fintech players or other technology players and others with new business models. At the end of the day, disruption is only a disruption if the customer's delighted by it, right? If it ends up being something that brings joy to that customer, makes them engage with your brands in a better way. And then why is it a risk at that point? If you're not participating in it, you will be disrupted by it. So my view is that we have to engage not just with fintech players, but with a broad set of players. And even in our own industry, we have to look at opportunities for co-opetition or collaboration in the right ways, where we're growing the pie, where we're expanding opportunities for customers to engage with our brands in different ways. I think in the financial services industry, I think some of the large players, the issuers, the big banks, need to be open to partnering more. Think about open APIs, think about white label solutions. Start exploring these opportunities proactively, or they're going to get explored on
without you.
Yes.
Yeah, I like to remind people, I think it's, first of all, it's just a good dose of confidence for all of us in the room. Some of the most disruptive and successful companies in the world right now, whether it's Amazon or Airbnb or iTunes or pick your favorite one, they wouldn't exist without all of us in the room. Wouldn't have happened. There wouldn't be an Amazon without
the U.S. banks, the payment networks, and the others that enable them to do what they do. You can't take cash, you can't take check. And so this idea of partnering with people that are disruptive, that are changing people, it is in the DNA of the industry, however kind of uncomfortable it may feel at times, and however stressed some of the principles that we all have may feel by the partnership decisions that we make. And you know, as we think about the next generation of kind of commerce behemoths that are going to happen, that are happening in this new connected world, I go back to what Margaret said. I think it's really important that we all have a clear set of principles. And you know, our bias, and I think all of our bias up here, is to engage. The right kind of initial instinct is to engage, to try to provide something that's ultimately better for the consumer. That's, you know, what this all is about, or the client at the end of it. But to do so with an agreed upon and clear set of principles. And you know, I think the more that we're aligned on those principles, the more as an industry we're going to be able to affect change and have a common approach to how we partner with them. And you know, as an issuer, you want someone who's going to partner that's going to respect your or your partner's brand, that's going to respect the end relationship with the client that the banks and other financial institutions have in the room. That becomes paramount. I also thought the point that Ginny made earlier about the data and the insights becomes an incredibly important principle to enter into those types of partnerships. But you know, I agree. We have to engage. We just have to do it smart with kind of the right ingoing framework on how to do so and be success. Are there, as you guys are sitting up here and think about it, are there examples that you would cite of what you think about as successful or constructive, or things that could be successful or constructive in terms of partnerships between the industry more broadly and fintechs?
I can just use one we did, which I think has worked out to be very successful for us. We partner with a company called GP Shopper. And you know, GP Shopper's model was really to build mobile apps for retailers. And they were out, particularly working with some of the smaller to mid-sized retailers who don't have resources in their company to go build mobile apps.
Sure.
And you know, we've been able to work so effectively with them. They've done a bunch of things for us that really have accelerated our ability in terms of how we're integrating into our partners' apps. We have this something that we launched with them that we announced back at Monday 2020 called SciPy, which literally takes 12 seconds to upload into the retailer's app. So this is an example where, you know, we might have gotten there, but we would never have gotten there in that accelerated way had we not partnered with a company like GP Shopper. Another one we're working with is a company called Flex Receipts, where, you know, you get your receipt right in your app. And there's another one where we probably could have gone off and developed it. Probably would have took us a really long time. Partners were already using some of our partners were already using Flex Receipts. So I think, again, what we're trying to look at and where the fintechs can really help us is these gaps, right? These gaps that we have, maybe in our process or in our technology, where we can fill the gap much more quickly by partnering with a fintech who can help us accelerate, you know, our thinking. And you know, it's not only accelerating the development of the application or whatever you're doing, it's also just the culture of how they work and getting our team teamed with them. You learn a lot through these processes that I think are really helpful to the whole organization.
Sebastian, from more the retailer angle, are there partnerships between fintechs and the financial services industry that you would look at as successful or high opportunity?
I think, you know, the obvious example that you can look at that's been really beneficial to our business is biometric technology, allowing for Touch ID to be able to do, to be able to transact more easily, remove friction, maintain trust and security for the consumer. It's done wonders for our business in terms of conversion rates and checkout lines and things like that. And anything that, again, makes it easier, removes friction for the customer and keeps it secure is a perfect example. I think there's a lot of interesting things looking forward around conversational commerce and other things that will be additional examples of where I think fintech players are going to play a really significant role in helping us to move the ball forward.
Great. So let's shift gears for a sec. Part of the whole point of this conference is thinking out farther and really challenging ourselves in terms of thinking how do we all need to change. So Sebastian, go to you. And just in terms of retail, you have a kind of a privileged view of what's going on in the retail world. If you think out 10 years, or if you can even go out 15 years, how is the whole consumer experience going to change? And what does it mean for all the people in the room? What does it mean we need to be thinking differently or more boldly in terms of our businesses today?
Yeah, look, first of all, 10 to 15 years, who the hell knows, right? I mean, I have a hard time focusing too much that far out, because I think things are moving so fast that 3 to 5 years is plenty. There'll be a tremendous amount of change in the next 3 to 5, let alone 10 to 15. That said, look, a lot is made about the death of the store relative to the digital offering. My personal view is that the store will not only survive, it'll thrive, and it'll be a basis of real differentiation. And it's really about how you de-average that experience for the consumer in the store experience. Some customers will want to come in and they will have already gone through the entire shopping journey, and they don't want to interact with one human being. They just want to pick something up or try it or what have you. In other cases, people will want heavy touch. They'll want somebody to advise them on what their personal style should be. We have to be able to meet the customer where they are and how they want to be met. And so we're going to have to do a much better job in the retail space evolving that physical experience. And then more importantly, if you step back from just the physical experience, a lot is made about omnichannel, of the term omnichannel. But omni, I think, is a misleading term, because it talks specifically, it at least connotes the transaction itself. And what we really need to think about is the entire customer journey, from end to end, around what inspires her, all the way through to what she's shopping for when she has that transaction. And then, most importantly, what's the ongoing relationship with that retailer or with those brands? And how do you maintain that relationship through loyalty and other means to keep it going and to enrich that experience and to make it valuable for the consumer? So my view of the next 3 to 5 and 10 to 15 is that there's going to be a lot of technology enablement of those things, of enriching the store experience or customizing that store experience, using mobile technology, using beacons, using AR and VR, et cetera. Lots of enabling technologies, but ultimately in service to delighting the customer, deepening that ongoing relationship, and connecting with her all the way through that journey with the brands that we have.
As you just follow up on that real quick, so as you think about the banks and financial services companies and payment networks and others in the audience, are there things that we need to be, in your view, doing differently, thinking about differently, approaching the industry differently to enable where you see everything going?
I just bring it full circle. Partner with us, right? Talk about how we can share information and data with each other. Talk about how we can experiment with new solutions. I mean, I think we'll come to this later, I think, but we have to work shoulder to shoulder. There's a theme that we've been pushing inside our business of becoming agile and operating in scrum teams and moving fast. We need to be able to do that inside the enterprise, but we need to do it with our FinTech and financial services providers as well. We need to be working shoulder to shoulder on testing new solutions and working together to see what kind of breakthroughs we can provide that, again, add value for the customer.
Margaret, future of retail, as many years out as you
all
can see.
I think it's a lot of what Sebastian already said. I think you're going to see the environment in store change in terms of the experience itself. I think technology is going to play a lot more a piece of that, whether it's virtual reality or, you know, how you check out or don't check out at a register. I think the whole register point of sale thing is going to be a floating register. I mean, you're already seeing some of that being tested. I mean, Apple's a good example of that, where you just check out. I think you're going to see all of that. But I think, I do think the store's not going to go away. I do still think people like to shop. And we forget sometimes about 92% of goods today are still bought in store. So it's going to take a little bit of while. I think we may be over-retailed right now, which is why you're hearing a lot of noise around retail itself. So I think there's probably too many brick-and-mortar retailers where we're going to see some of that come down, and online's going to pick up. But I still think shopping is an experience that people are going to still want to do. And I just think the way they do it, and to Sebastian's point, how that customer wants to shop is going to be the critical point, right, of, you know, how I go in the store, what I want. Do I want to just pick it up, or do I want to try it on, or do I want to see other things, or do I want someone helping me or not helping me when I walk in the dressing room, or, you know, Right. Those types of things. So I think that's going to change, but I don't think brick-and-mortar retail is going away.
Same question I asked Sebastian, but as a follow-up, is are there things you think as an industry we need to be doing differently, more quickly, more provocatively, to enable where retail is going to make sure relevant?
I think the biggest opportunity for us, and I know this is with us in Gap and to some extent Visa, is really the data experience. I think we all have a ton of it. We're all trying to figure out how do we make that more real time.
Right.
And how do we get to a better understanding of what the customer is really doing and how they're transacting and what they're purchasing and where they're going? And I think there's an opportunity for us to be smarter about how we maybe share data together to really make that experience better for the customer that's, for instance, going into the Gap, because we all have pieces of things. You know, so if we can put that window together, I think that will really help, I think, our at least our clients get a better understanding of how their customer's transacting, and then how does that connect to the experience they want.
Yeah, I agree with that. I think just maybe echoing a little bit what both of you said, I think there's a point in time not too far along when every transaction is going to be digital first. And not historically how we've thought about it is going onto a computer, but whether it's at the POS register, whether it's interacting with a salesperson who has a tablet, what have you, every single transaction will be digital first, or at least that's the way I think we ought to think about it. And it is happening at a pace that we've never seen. I just went and looked at just the Visa transaction data during the holidays, right, from November to December, from November 1st through the end of the year. And if you take out kind of Visa-specific factors, just look at what happened in the holidays. The shift to digital it's massive. The e-commerce grew more than four times faster than stores did during the holidays. It was more than a quarter of all of the spending that Americans spent during November and December. If you just look at how much in sales came out of the stores and went online just during the last 2 months of the year, it was $14 billion. $14 billion of spending that was in stores last holiday period now is online. And it's changing the way all of us actually shop. So, you know, there was a time just a few years ago when this idea of Cyber Monday was this big new thing, right? There's one day during the holidays when we'll go buy online. And the numbers showed it. Cyber Monday was a huge day. Cyber Monday wasn't even in the top 10 holiday sales this year of all Visa spending, wasn't even in the top 10. And it's also, it's enabled us to be, as a colleague of mine, Oliver Jenkin, likes to say, a nation of procrastinators. So if you look at how many of the top 10 shopping days of the whole holiday season were in the last 2 weeks before Christmas, 8 out of 10. 8 out of 10 top 10 shopping days during the holiday season were in the last 2 weeks right before Christmas, because all of these new capabilities have enabled us all to do that. So I think it's happening at speed faster than anything we've seen in a long time.
Let me just pile on with one comment. You know, we like to say, I agree with you, all transactions will ultimately begin as digital one way or another. But we think that's, you know, no offense, an amazing statement. I was in China a few months ago.
Yeah.
I'm not going to give a number, but as soon as we turned on contactless digital payments, it just lit up, right? I mean, because the Chinese consumer starts there, right? We're in a transition and an evolution and disruption, as we call it here. It's already happened there. They've started in a different place, and we need to, you know, come to grips with that here, because emerging markets are really the ones that are leading the way right now with what the future of this world will look like.
So how do you all do that at the Gap? How do you all really understand how customer expectations are going to change and then kind of build the business system to promote that?
Yeah, so I'll start by saying anybody who thinks that they're going to predict everything the customer's going to do is kidding themselves. That said, there are a couple of things that we need to do and that we are doing. First and foremost, it comes back to what was just mentioned, which is the data. So we need to leverage the data and information that our customers trust us to allow us to have, that they provide to us, as well as third-party data, whether it's weather data, transaction data, traffic data, you name it, in ways that allow us to be more predictive about customer behavior, what's going to make her tick, why she's coming into a store, or why she's not coming into a store, whatever the case may be. So that is something we just need to continue to push the envelope on. And again, we need to leverage third parties for that. We can't develop all of that internally. We need to partner along the way. The second, though, but to me that's necessary but insufficient, ultimately. I think we also need to really think about testing. And I mentioned it earlier. The only way you're going to know if it's something that she really wants is if you put it in front of her and you let her try it. And we need to get into a much more aggressive posture about rapidly testing and learning and occasionally failing, but we'll learn from the failures. But we will succeed ultimately, and we'll be out front if we're taking a much more aggressive stance in testing new solutions and new offerings for the customer.
One thing that we're doing differently than we've done in the past, and this gets back to you don't really know what the customer really wants until you put it in front of them. But you know, a lot of our innovation, particularly on our mobile app and digitally, we actually bring real consumers in. We've actually gone to consumers' houses and actually watched them as they've gone through the path of a journey of shopping. And you know, as we've built new capability where you might think, for instance, they want everything on one page, they say that, but the reality is they really don't. So I think you have to get as close as you possibly can to the customer experience and really test it with the customer. And so in our innovation labs that we have three of them. The one we have in Stanford is on digital. We not only do it with real customers, but we also bring our partners in as well. And you know, we're always looking at what's the problem we're trying to solve for the customer. Sometimes we think we're solving a bigger problem than maybe it is. But I think getting as close as you possibly can get to that customer experience and watching the customer operate, I think is really critical. And we've learned a lot through that process. And something that we're doing as we develop all new technology. I think it's just, you think you know what they want, they think they know what they want, but then when they actually go and do it, it's different.
It is, yeah, and exactly. Let's go back to data, because data's been like a theme throughout. We talked about the importance of data and providing that kind of future retail experience. How do you make it happen in reality? And also maybe Sebastian, to start with you on this one, how do you avoid, as a retailer, kind of the creepy factor, if you will, right? So of being too knowledgeable about your consumer, and does that then unwind some of the permissions that they've been willing to give you that Jenny talked about earlier?
Yeah, I mean, I think at the end of the day, the rule is the customer will decide. They'll decide how much data they're willing to share with you. They'll decide how much they trust you. They'll decide, ultimately, how much value they're getting out of whatever you're producing as a result of having access to that data. So yes, there's a delicate balance, and obviously you need to follow all the appropriate rules and regulations of how you leverage data. But ultimately, I think trust is what determines how much of the data you can leverage, and value determines whether they're going to continue to let you get access to it. And as long as we're developing solutions that she thinks are delighting her and she's getting value out of, I think the data will continue to flow.
You agree, Margaret, or how do you think?
Yeah, I think there's a generational aspect to this, which is, you know, millennials are willing to share everything. You know, so I do think if you go through the different generations, there's probably a different fear factor around how much data I share and not share. But when you get down to the millennials, they're pretty much, you know, if you look at Venmo, they share like what they spent their dollar on, a glass of wine with little emojis, and everybody knows what they did. I think it goes back to being thoughtful, making sure you understand what the customer is really willing to allow for them individually. But I think this whole data experience is going to really accelerate, particularly as this millennial generation is just, they're more willing to share. And they want things fast, and they want their experience a certain way. And you know, I think we're going to see lots of good opportunities down the road as we continue to explore the data area. But again, we got to make sure we do it in a thoughtful and in a regulatory environment, and all those other things.
Yeah.
But
again, Sebastian, back to you. We've heard a little bit about AI today, not a lot about VR, artificial intelligence, not a lot yet about virtual reality and those types of things. As a retailer. As a consumer, that stuff feels pretty far out, to be honest. As a retailer, how important is it?
I actually think it's going to be a really critical enabler of, again, the experience and the journey and connecting the journey. I don't know if anyone saw, but last week at CES, the president of our Gap brand was on stage with Google and the Google Tango team announcing a pilot program for a new app on the Google Play Store in about a month. Where we'll be leveraging augmented reality for a customer to either come into the store or at home shop for articles of clothing out of our assortment. They can put in their sizing, get an avatar. It actually is looking at the composition of the garment, so it actually shows how it drapes on the body. Is it the ultimate solution? No, but it's a great early experiment, and we're going to learn from it, and you know, we'll see how the customer engages with it. And again, it's different strokes for different folks. Some customers are going to want that. They're going to want access to that, and we're going to provide it to those who want it, and some won't, and that's fine too.
So. Are you guys involved in these types of technologies, Margaret, what you're doing?
Well, you know, we just did something back in the fall where we actually replicated what we think a store could look like. And, you know, one of the examples we use VR is particularly in, you know, sports, right, or kayaking. We actually used Alexa to ask Alexa what we should do today because I have a free day. Alexa suggested kayaking. And then you went into the next area where you sat and you actually got the experience of kayaking. And then you went right into the store, ordered it right online. So I do think these things are going to come together. So we do think there is an opportunity here. And it will be part of the experience. I think it'll be different depending on the type of retailer, but it will be part of the experience.
I look forward to it. I'm going to close by picking up on one comment that Sebastian made around mistakes. There's no question that we're all going to make mistakes as we work through kind of all the different decisions we have to make in terms of partnering and enabling different technologies over the course of the next 1, 2, 5, 10 years. But I think, again, our view is we have to engage, we have to have clear principles, and we have to be willing to make mistakes. And for most of the people in the room that are in the financial services industry, again, I kind of bring back to the confidence that you all have in terms of enabling all of these different experiences and players and retailers. They really don't exist without all of us. You ask one of the FinTech players in the room how well FinTechs do without any type of partnership with the financial services industry, it just doesn't exist. No such thing as a successful FinTech player who hasn't partnered with someone who's in the financial services industry. So I think as we all think forward about the types of partnerships, thinking both smartly but aggressively about how we engage and doing it with the types of principles that are going to allow us to be successful. And if we make mistakes, we'll pivot and move forward. But looking forward to the course of the next day. Thanks to my colleagues and partners up here. And I think I'm going to bring Allison back on stage to take us to the next part of the agenda. Thank you.
Thank you.